So let me welcome you to the third season of the Village Square. I'll start by introducing the gentleman to my right, who is a not only a great county commissioner, but has become a great friend and a guy that I love working with on issues and certainly enjoy chairing this event with, and that's County Commissioner Chip LaMarca. Chip, thanks. We serve as co-chairs of the Village Square, which is the Village Square Advisory Board, and we're delighted all of you could join us this evening for this event. It's good to see many of you that have supported us over the last 2 years, and now this is the start of the third year. It's kind of exciting. For those of you who've been with us before, you know what this is all about. We ask you, first of all, to pull out your cell phones. If you're on social media, post that you're here at the Village Square. Most times they say pull out those cell phones, they say turn them off or turn the ringer off, right? Exact opposite. We want you to post that you're here at the Village Square. You can tweet. You can send it out. You can even friend Justin Safey on that one. He'll retweet it all over the state of Florida, so it'll be awesome. Hashtag is at Village Square and at Broward College. For those of you that are new to the Village Square, this is a forum where we can have a civilized debate, a comfortable, safe discussion of the issues, and actually, let's just call it a contrast to what's happening right now on the national level. At the Village Square, you'll hear viewpoints from both those in favor and those who oppose an issue. It's important for people to see that the individuals with opposing views or different political backgrounds can come together and their views have an elevated, they can bring their views and have an elevated conversation about the topic. And I would think after the last couple months, we have not had an elevated conversation about any political topic in this country. So this should also be very enlightening. Chip and I were joking, the hurricane was actually a welcome break from the presidential election. So we do this through our Dinner at the Square and our Takeout Tuesdays. The event tonight is what we call a Dinner at the Square, and it is a signature Village Square event. The debate will be spirited, it'll be fact-based, it'll be civil, and the dinner is included in your ticket price. The Takeout Tuesday series are free and open to the public as they want to make the Village Square accessible to all. On Takeout Tuesdays, bring your favorite takeout dinner, bring a drink, and join us to learn about a hot topic facing the local community. Hosting these events would not be possible without the leadership and vision of President David Armstrong from Broward College. I don't believe David's here with us tonight, but I will tell you, you talk about a true community builder. You talk about a guy that took his position as president of a college and said, you know what, I can do that and much more. How about a round of applause for David Armstrong? And then a night like tonight's not possible without sponsors, and we are so lucky tonight to have a sponsorship from a top, not only Fort Lauderdale law firm, statewide law firm, national law firm, but now international law firm, and that's Greenberg Traurig. Where's the Greenberg Traurig table? And we want to say thank you. Jeff Hirsch is here from Greenberg. Thank you. And we also want to thank our advisory board members from the Village Square with us tonight. You'll see them wearing a member button. Membership is just $68 a year and supports the mission and programming of the Village Square. Members get to attend a pre-dinner cocktail reception with our speakers. And also, if you're interested in becoming a member, you may refer to the information in your program and sign at the door. Could I just have the members please stand up for a second so we can say thank you. And I want you to look around for a second at this membership. These are people that believe in the community, that believe in a better Fort Lauderdale and a better Broward County, not through a Republican way or Democratic way, but through a better way. And I really appreciate this board that we have, the Board of Advisors, because it makes our job so much easier to have a bipartisan, nonpartisan group to work with, so thank you. Also, we want to thank our official partner, the Greater Fort Lauderdale Alliance and the Broward League of Cities. The chair this year of the Broward League of Cities is represented is Greg Ross, Mayor Ross from Cooper City. Thank you, Mayor, please stand. And Bob Swindell from the Greater Fort Lauderdale Alliance could not be with us tonight, but another great community builder. Who's that? Oh, Maggie Gunther's here from the Greater. Maggie, please stand. Greater Fort Lauderdale Alliance. At this time, let me ask Chip LaMarca to give us the rules of the evening, the rules of engagement for tonight's civil debate.
Thank you, Mayor. So two quick things I want to. Can you hear them? Okay. I want to identify and thank and welcome at least one, maybe another one on their way, of our Broward College Board of Trustee members, David Maiman and his lovely wife, Marla. I believe Mike Rump will be coming, so if you see him, say hello. I want to thank everyone for being here. You know, two or almost 3 years ago, when this came together here in Broward County, at least one of the discussions was myself with a county commissioner in Leon County in Tallahassee, who has the same unique position that I do. I call it a position of strength. He's the minority leader on his board. There are seven members on Leon County, and he's the only Republican on their board. But he's been the chair twice, and maybe we can learn something from him down here. But he had a debate set up with his good friend, who is a very liberal Democrat from New York, and they said, let's put this together. I know this was the impetus of it, but when somebody said, well, bring us down to Broward County, in my mind, I said, well, I want to do it. Not a lot of people in my side of the aisle, so it was easy to find me, but I said, who's the perfect person to do this with? Looked at the county commission, then I looked at myself, and I said, well, I represent Jack Seiler. He's my constituent, and he does a great job. He's been doing a great job in the city of Fort Lauderdale for many years, so it's a pleasure to do this Village Square with you, Jack. I know we had a little bit of fun on Channel 10 today. I see Glenna Milberg's here on Sunday, and we'll do it again soon, I hope. So tonight, for our first dinner at the Square, we delve into another heated topic, post-traumatic election syndrome. Can the political parties survive the politics of hate and the anti-establishment movement? Before we begin, we want to make you aware of a few announcements to tell you about the ground rules. So tonight, we're going to be talking about a topic that we don't necessarily agree on. To keep the conversation civil and informative, I'd like to caution you against what we call team clapping. When you clap with your side, says something you agree with, maybe give a little groan when you disagree. We'd like you to do neither of those. Tonight, we'd like to challenge you to work hard and listen to both sides of the story. Just in case you need a reminder, we have our civility bell, which is in the trusty hands of Adriana Fasano, the chief of staff at Broward College. We've asked her to be particularly sensitive to either side of the aisle and ring the bell if she hears demonizing. Adriana, please ring the bell to give everyone an example. Now that's going to work here for us because I have faith in everyone here. It won't work on the next other one, presidential debate. So a portion of this evening will be Q&A, and there's a podium and a mic in the back of the room if you'd like to ask a question. So please be conscious of your time when asking questions. Please don't give us a statement, ask the panel a question, because we want to get as many questions in as possible, and I think you saw that the other night as well, it was like four questions. Lastly, I have the pleasure of welcoming our guest panelists and moderator for this evening, so please help me in welcoming our panelists, Mr. Mitchell Berger. Mitchell's with Berger Singerman, and probably the go-to guy in Broward County for the Democrat Party. My friend Ed Pozzuoli of Trip Scott probably has the same position, well, until this time, as being the number one advisor for anyone running for president when they come to Broward County as a Republican. And Justin Safey, who was with Ballard Partners, also the Safey Review. And if you wake up at 5 o'clock in the morning, he's already got the latest political information in your inbox. Last but certainly not least, somebody that I don't think most of folks I know knew anything about until this most recent primary season, but he is a law professor at Nova Southeastern University, Mr. Tim Canova. And our moderator this evening is Glenna Milberg with WPLG Local 10 News. We're extremely fortunate to have them all here this evening and encourage you to read their bios in your program, as these are some incredible individuals. Now on to our programming. Before we begin our debate, we will watch a short video on why America has only two parties. I would argue that the third party has the most registered no-party affiliates. But this is on two parties. Again, thank you for your support. We hope you stay and enjoy the evening. The program will begin. I think the mayor has something left to say, sir.
Just one last thing to say, folks. We're here at Hughes Catering, and for those of you that know Hughes Catering and Hugh McCauley, they are always here for us in the community, probably more charitable events, giving back to the community. How about a round of applause for Hughes Catering? And with that, I'll turn it over to Glenna Milberg.
only one in heels here, standing on the edge, living on the edge. Hello, everybody. Is it okay to acknowledge all that wine on the back row there? I'm kind of a Dade girl, so I've been on the road for an hour and a half, which is, I think, the next topic here, regional transportation, right? Yeah. So anyway, thank you, and thank you for having me here tonight. I've interviewed everybody up here, and usually when we go for interviews, I feel like I'm looked at sort of like walking into the lion's den, but here I kind of feel like, good, compadres. We're all in the same, and it's friendly, and it's good. And for the record, I'm an NPA, no party affiliation, by virtue of what I do for a living, but also, honestly, and it's been a really fun election year. I use that word kind of lightly, right? Has it not? So as a first-timer here, I'm just kind of going to wing it for a little while with some questions. And is this more like a conversation, right? Not just a Q&A? And I think it'll be a lot more fun and interesting and intimate. Okay. So what I want to start with, since we have such an interesting topic, post-election traumatic syndrome, I don't think we have to wait post-election. I think we're pretty traumatized right now in so many ways. So let's talk to the teenager at the end working on his phone. Mr. Canova, how are you?
Doing well.
And I channel my teenage kids too. So let's start with you tonight if we can. And let's start with sort of a broad question. Is aside from Donald Trump, who has changed the game no matter how you look at it, is this election so different from elections in the past, like in the 60s and in the 80s, that were really contentious, and why?
I think every election is a bit different. And what makes this election different from the 60s, I think, is that the times are so different. The 1960s, the American dream was still alive and strong for a lot of folks. Society was divided over Vietnam, the war on poverty. No doubt there were a lot of tensions. But 2008 saw the biggest financial crisis since the Great Depression, and it's been a very incomplete recovery for a lot of folks. Those at the top are doing real well, and the establishment, this conversation is about how the two establishment parties are going to fare in the future. The establishment is as strong as ever in some ways, but I think there's a decline in legitimacy for the establishment parties among ordinary working folks.
All right, that's a good place to pick up. Why is there, what has happened to delegitimize the parties?
I would argue that the response to the downturn in 2008 was very different from the response to the downturn in the Great Depression in the 1930s. Probably now more than ever, what's needed is a New Deal approach. Is jobs, programs, and education, support for middle class and working folks. It hasn't really happened. It's been a trickle-down, top-down approach, even from a Democratic administration.
All right, so you're talking, I hear some of the themes that we talked about when you were running for Congress. Ed, the look on your face indicates you get to talk next. And so, so let's go into, you know, that. What effect has that had on this election? First of all, do you agree or not? And why would that have such an effect on the tone of this election?
I think, actually, I'm going to compliment Tim Canova. He brought a lot to the election process. And he challenged the most established Congress person that we have in Broward and in the country. And you took her on the left. And frankly, that was a good wake-up call for the Democratic establishment. And so for that, Tim, congratulations.
Thank you.
I would also say that while we may disagree as to the idea about how to fix it and why, but clearly there are symptoms that we can agree on, that there is an anti-establishment sentiment on both sides of the aisle, and more importantly, there's some 28% of Florida voters who are no party, neither Republican or Democrat, mm-hmm. And clearly they are not part of the establishment by virtue of how they're registering. All of them don't work for Channel 10, right? So so clearly they're not as part of the establishment. And there's a reason for that. Government is not listening to what the people say, and it has become a little bit of an insider game. And we see it acting out in different ways, both on the Republican side and the Democratic side. There was one thing I do want to put context to, Gwenna, is that this idea of hate, this is an election of hate. I will say to you that there was an election that one party called the other so bad and moralless that your women and children would be forced into prostitution. And then the other party called the other candidate so ruthless and moralless as to not be a woman or a man, but to just be neither. And that election was the 1800 election between Adams and Jefferson. And so, you know, Mitch and I have had lunch. We've kind of discussed some of this, not before this, but years and years ago. So the idea of that this election is any different than some elections in the past, I want to put some context around that.
I'm glad you did, because that was kind of the question. So Mitch, since you've talked behind our backs a little bit, the concept of hate in this election is front and center every day, from the basket of deplorables on one side to everything else on the other. Right now, the Republican candidate is at war with pretty much everyone who is not one of his followers. How do we get over that after this election, whomever wins?
Look, I think that the modern political process is an assault on reason. We no longer use reason to analyze how we have gotten where we are. It is truly an attempt to incite emotion. When you get most of your information from TV or other media, you are no longer reasoning. It hits your ocular nerve. It goes to your reptilian brain, and you either want to agree or disagree immediately instead of wanting to reason as to how we have gotten here.
Can I object at this point?
No.
It's a court of law.
Some brains are more reptilian than others.
No, you can't. That's why we are starting to...
Where's the bell?
That's why you start to subdivide into Fox News and MSNBC, and no one wants to read the paper anymore and determine what is actually happening. And oh, by the way, the rules of journalism, which have been revisited during the Trump campaign, used to be, and I helped to run a national campaign, used to be I would talk to a reporter and say, if I said to you that I'm on the phone with you right now, and that was the story, and someone from the other campaign disagreed that I was on the phone with you right now, you'd have to report, I said I was on the phone, and the other person said I disagreed I was on the phone with you, but this reporter observed that I was on the phone. You couldn't report that. Well, now, that used to be the way Walter Cronkite reported the news. Now people need to report both opinions on what's happening as to the facts of what's happening. Now, getting that to the partisan divide, the facts are as follows. In 1950, we were the only country in the world producing goods and services. The rest of the world was bombed out. Russia had lost 25 million people. England was bombed. France was bombed. China was bombed. We dropped two nuclear bombs on Japan. By the time 1970 came along, these countries started to produce goods and services again and compete with us. We are now in a competitive world. Both parties don't want to deal with that. Instead, we have run up a $20 trillion debt, and we tell everyone, don't worry about it, right? We tell everyone, don't worry about it. So to Mr. Canova's point, right, he is saying we needed to deal with the 2008 problem in the way we dealt with the 1932 problem. We already had $14 or $15 trillion in debt by 2008. So you're a middle-class person and it's 2008 or 2009. What happens? We lend $1 trillion to the bank at 1% interest, right? You're still paying 5 or 6% interest on your home loan or your car loan. You're not an idiot. When you paid your $5,000 in taxes to be lent back to you at 500 basis points more, you got a little upset. So then what did the president do? He creates a healthcare system that creates more health insurance for the lower classes. You're in the middle class, you don't need that. So that's where another $1 trillion goes out. That gets you upset as well. And then what happens with the stimulus program is it goes to the state governments like Florida, who can't balance their budgets, in order to have them pay their pension funds, union pension funds. So if you're in the middle class, you're upset at everyone at this point in time. And oh, by the way, we spent $5 trillion on three wars that no one wanted to be in. So, and both parties don't want to deal with this. And so the parties are losing their legitimacy because they don't want to deal with the issues that they're being confronted with. Instead, we're talking about the 10 women who criticized Donald Trump today and the WikiLeaks on Hillary Clinton. Is that what we want out of our political process? Or are we going to start to deal with these issues?
Can I just frame how media deals with what you just talked about? I want to see a very honest show of hands for those people who followed word for word the calculations that Mitch just talked about. Thank you for being honest. This is an illustration of what news deals with. Complicated things, issues, calculations are not easily done in a soundbite or in, is it, who reads the paper? Wow, Sun Sentinel and Herald friends will be really happy.
Yeah.
So Justin Safey, who I think you were sort of on the cusp of internet news, you were ahead of your time. Let's of all the things Mitch just talked about, let's sort of stick with that really good point. Media is supposed to be a public service. Media is supposed to be the deliverer of fact so that people can be an informed electorate. As someone in sort of that business, and you are, right?
Yes, I
am. Yeah, okay. So let's talk about that, the challenges, and where does the media go wrong, and can it be made right to make an informed electorate happen?
Well, so the interesting thing about the media today is the internet. And if you asked earlier, I'm going to answer the question, but also answer the question earlier, what's different, is there anything different about this year? I think, yeah, I mean, we're finally experiencing a campaign that's fully immersed with the power of the internet. And that has a number of different implications. Tim Canova would not have been able to raise $3.5 million. $3.8 million against the chairwoman of the Democratic National Committee, member of Congress, but for the internet. Agree or disagree?
Absolutely agree.
Okay. So that enables Tim to raise $3.8 million. The internet is also where people are getting a lot of their information. I have three teenage children. They'll never read a newspaper. I tried one time and they looked at me like I had three heads. And they get their information from their cell phones. They don't really even get it from television. They don't watch television. They watch more videos and news on Facebook and on Instagram and on Snapchat than they do on the nice 50-inch TV screen I have in my home.
But does that speak to the quality of it or just the medium?
It speaks to, I think, the quality of it, but because obviously the media that they're consuming on their digital devices is different than, I think, of a lesser quality, quite honestly. But what I was getting at is that the consumption of news today, when I was growing up, there were three television networks, there was one hometown newspaper, And that was really it. The sources of information were more finite. Now the sources of information are infinite. And you basically can subscribe to your news. You can subscribe to your news source. And I think that people are kind of living in a kind of a walled garden of their choosing, where they are consuming information that continues to reinforce the belief that they already have. And they're not really getting exposed to thoughts, ideas, or beliefs that are different from their own. And again, I say it's because of the internet. And so I'm not, you know, look, I'm in the internet news business, so I'm not criticizing it. I'm making an observation about this incredible tool, probably the most, you know, really remarkable and impactful discovery that we've ever had in human history, but the impact it's having on our political system and on people's concept of what's going on in their world because of where they're getting their information.
So let's test that out in the village square. In a show of hands. You don't have to say what or where you watch or why you watch it, but who here tends to watch the cable channels, the pundits, who align with their own political beliefs? That's okay, significant. And who is the opposite? Who samples some of the networks that they know they're not going to agree with? And so who thinks this is an average audience? No. But that's a really interesting point. And so, Tim, in your campaign, because that we met during your campaign,
yes.
And I'm covering every campaign that we cover at Channel 10 has surrogates and talking points and marketing, and it's very hard to interview the candidate the higher you go and ask the kind of questions that they don't have a talking point to. How, for your campaign and in what you do, how truthful and base are you when you're talking to the media or presenting yourself in public, or do you have a marketing plan where you show a certain public face? And so when you're interviewed by either MSNBC or Fox News, you have talking points that you want to get out to that audience.
I thought you were in the process of asking me whether I had one answer in private and another in public.
Well, and you know what? That's an excellent point, because in the experience of news reporters that I know, that is not unusual.
I think that's partly what's wrong with our politics today. And I'm not a politician. I've been a law professor for 20 years. So I've studied a lot of the issues that I tried to highlight during the campaign, and I feel like I was very authentic. And it didn't matter if I was on Fox or MSNBC, I was still trying to get the same talking points across. The questions I received were very different. On Fox News, it was, well, Bernie Sanders endorsed you, and you support Bernie Sanders, so aren't you a socialist? I wasn't getting those kind of questions on MSNBC.
Mitch?
I totally disagree with what Tim said. In 1940, Franklin Roosevelt ran for president of the United States. He told the American people he would never get them in the war against Nazi Germany, and he was already in the war against Nazi Germany. You know, their leadership at times requires, as Abraham Lincoln with the 13th Amendment, different positions in public than in private. I have experienced this my entire adult life in politics. In order to bring consensus to a position, people need to make deals. And that means you have a public position and a private position. Those of us who have practiced law understand that. And in order to have a mature, a constitutional republic, which if you still wish to have one, you need to accept that that's how it works. Now, in terms of the news media, it is their job to expose the difference between the public position and the private position. In terms of you as citizens, it is your job to understand that that's how it works, because otherwise it will never work. And I don't think Ed will disagree with me on that, or Justin will disagree with me on that. I have been in many negotiations. Helms-Burton was on the Cuba embargo. I've been in more negotiations than I know what to tell you on, where people have public positions and private positions in order to get bills passed. That doesn't happen anymore in Congress. It just doesn't happen anymore. And the country is falling apart because of it.
So
feel free to jump on it. This is kind of like a dinner party without the wine, so you can jump on it.
I'm a lawyer also, and I've worked on Capitol Hill, so I certainly understand the art of compromise and how necessary it is. Mitch just said part of the job of the news media is to question candidates to bring out the differences between their public and private positions.
Absolutely.
I don't think that happens very often. Unfortunately, it takes WikiLeaks to highlight the difference between public and private positions right now. And I return to my opening point, which is the real problem in our politics today is that our politicians are so busy with the art of the deal for special interests. Even the Conference Board, a pro-business group, talked about how ossified our political institutions have become, how our economy has become a crony capitalistic system, and politicians are not addressing the needs of real people. That's what's really wrong with our politics today.
Ed?
I'm gonna jump in here just a second at the risk of getting between two Democrats fighting. I've learned to be quiet and let them go at it a little bit.
That's what we're doing right
now. That's right.
Publicly.
But there's a difference between the art of compromise and finding a compromise that satisfies both principled positions. So that is where we've lost that art. It is, however, different when in matters of principle where you have somebody principle issues saying something in private, and then for purposes of being elected or to satisfy the audience that they're speaking in front of, something totally different that is absolutely abhorrent to their principle, to the degree that's said so often among some public officials that the public loses faith in what that person stands for. And so that is not, I believe, what Mitchell is talking about. But I do believe Tim is talking about it. There has to be a core belief system of somebody who is in elected office about what they believe. And people need to understand that and be comfortable with it so that they know what they're voting for. That inspires some level of trust and integrity. It doesn't mean that person cannot compromise with someone on the other side of the aisle. But what it does mean, and they may pay the price for it with certain portions of their electorate, but it doesn't mean that you discard your principles that you truly believe. Well, if you're someone who has no principles, then it's easy.
So are you saying that candidates now are not as principled as they were before?
Before Ed goes there, okay. In 1800, Thomas Jefferson ran for office, right, as a states' rightist, but became a Federalist. In 1860, Abraham Lincoln ran for office, and in 1863, he only freed the African Americans in the South, and he ran for office saying he would never, ever end slavery in the South. In 1940, Franklin Roosevelt ran for office saying he would never get us into World War II. I think that people need to be mature to know that people run for office with a set of guiding principles, but they always are addressing the circumstances to which they are given.
That there are circumstances that override. So as an example, when the state rightist of Thomas Jefferson is presented with the opportunity to expand the country through the Louisiana Purchase, he does so.
Correct.
Right? And he expands the country, and that's fine.
Called him a hypocrite, and everyone called Lincoln a hypocrite for only freeing African Americans in the rebelling states. And everyone called Roosevelt a hypocrite for the Lend-Lease program he did with Churchill. Yeah. And everyone called Reagan a hypocrite for Iran-Contra. You know, so all I am saying is people need to be mature and understand that elected leaders are confronted with immediate issues that often they have to deal with, notwithstanding their political philosophy.
But Lincoln's principle was to keep the Union together. That was his guiding principle that guided every other decision that overrode all the others. And so where you have an elected official who has no principle, is totally void of principle, then you have somebody who you cannot trust. And ultimately, that's the problem.
But I would say that the problem, if you consider a problem, is that there is no upside for any elected official in Washington to compromise. There's a lot of downside. We were talking about it earlier. In 2011, President Barack Obama and Republican House Speaker John Boehner sat down, lots of meetings. 2010, excuse me. Sat down lots of meetings in the White House trying to come up with a grand bargain, Republican Speaker of the House and a Democratic liberal, in my view, president. God bless them. That's what you want to see happen. That's people that had principles, but who were trying to reach a compromise to govern. And what happened? The president got pulled to the left, and John Boehner got pulled by the conservative caucus in the House, and ultimately, neither one of them could satisfy their constituencies in order to do a deal.
Worse happened, right? What ended up happening is we ended up lowering payroll taxes, further increasing, because both parties wanted to reduce taxes, so we ended up lowering payroll taxes, further exacerbating the national debt. That was the compromise they reached, right? So instead of both parties trying to reach a compromise that would have increased revenue, reduced certain portions of spending, we lowered payroll taxes, increasing the national debt, and we began a sequester, which, by the way, ISIS sees the sequester, which says we have reduced in our military right now over 500,000 people in our military. Both Russia and China see that because of the military sequester, as does ISIS. And that is the deal they made in 2010. It only hurt all of us. Instead of telling us we need to raise taxes, we need to raise taxes. Obama didn't want to raise the taxes like George Herbert Walker Bush did and lost his presidency, like Bill Clinton did and lost his House of Representatives. Obama wanted to get reelected. I'm saying that as a Democrat. So he reduced payroll taxes along with the Speaker of the House, who also wanted to maintain a House majority for the Republicans. And that's the compromise you get in Washington now.
Tim.
I worry more about when these parties do compromise with each other. In 1999, they got rid of the Glass-Steagall Act. In 2000, December, in a lame duck Congress, in a lame duck administration, they deregulated derivatives to make the economy a complete casino. In 2008, they compromised on TARP, the bank bailout, without sufficient strings to replace failed management of failed banks. Mm-hmm. When these parties get together to do the compromise, it's the American people that usually are the ones on the losing end. And the reason for that is that both parties are very beholden to special interests. It's the way the campaign finance system is run at this point. And I talked about this a lot during my campaign. Mm-hmm. Average members of Congress spending 30 hours a week begging for dollars, dialing for dollars. I was lucky. I hit the jackpot, so to speak. I could go on the internet and get $17 contributions. Because of the perception of my opponent. But most folks aren't that fortunate. They got to go dialing for dollars, and they become very beholden to these special interest groups. At the same time, I think our politics have drifted so far to the right that solutions that were acceptable in past decades no longer are. And I mentioned that this great recession of 2008 was the first recession since the Great Depression when there was not massive jobs programs. Even Reagan had jobs programs during his recession. In fact, Barack Obama's chief economic advisor, Austin Goolsbee, kept saying the same mantra: only the private sector can create jobs, the public sector can't.
You and I agree on that, but the three people that were bailed out were also the unions were bailed out.
Well, for some industries, right, the auto industry.
No, the union pension funds were bailed out in the state governments. There was $1 trillion sent down to the state governments to bail out union pension funds. So we took $1 trillion and we bailed out the banks. We took $1 trillion and we bailed out union pension funds.
What trillion dollars bailed out the pension funds? Because the $700 billion was TARP.
No. We also spent $800 billion down to the states. Right.
The $700 billion, $700 billion TARP money was divided by three.
No, but
one-third was Medicaid reimbursements.
We also had $1 trillion we sent to the states so the states could balance their budgets. Most of that money went back into union pension funds.
Okay. Well, the unions are a special interest in that regard, exactly. And a lot of the American people are not in unions, and they weren't taken
exactly.
care of.
Exactly.
Justin.
But what? Yeah, I think really what's interesting about Tim's perspective on this, I just loved when he said this, not that I necessarily agree with it, but it's symbolic of what's happening right now, which is his concern was he worries when the two parties get together and compromise because they've been so influenced by special interests. And that is something where it's remarkable. Another thing I think is different about this election year than in past election years is if you look at all the traditional kind of indicia of how America is doing, they're all, not I shouldn't say all, but many of the traditional indicia are pretty good. Interest rates are pretty low. Go get a car loan, go get a loan for your home, go get an equity loan for your home, pretty low. Inflation rates are pretty low. Unemployment rates are pretty low. Gas prices, relatively speaking, are pretty low. Stock market, pretty high. So if you look at all these traditional indicia, the economy's doing pretty well. The America is not at war in the traditional sense. So you always hear about peace and prosperity. Relatively speaking, obviously we're not growing at 4% a year or 3% a year and everything could be better. But relatively speaking, comparatively speaking, you wouldn't think that if you looked at all of those indicia, that when you poll Americans for the last several years, whether America is on the right track or on the wrong track, right now the Real Clear Politics average is about 30% of Americans think America is on the right track, 60% think we're on the wrong track. Even though you have low interest rates, low unemployment, low inflation, low gas prices, high stock market. So something's going on that's fueling the dissent, that's fueling the angst that gave rise to Bernie Sanders raising, Bernie raised $230 million against Hillary Clinton as of June 30th when the primary ended. And Hillary Clinton raised $231 million. And Donald Trump, I don't really have to explain what he did. He beat seven Republican governors. Here's a gentleman who's never held political office before in his life. And a lot of that is, again, I kind of see a lot of similarities between the Bernie Sanders phenomenon and the Donald Trump phenomenon, which I would call roughly, I would call it populist, which kind of is a little bit of what I heard from Tim, which is I get worried when the two parties and the power structure up in Washington, D.C. get together and start deciding things. So to me, there's a Donald Trump kind of represents a protest vote against the power structure in Washington, and Bernie Sanders represents kind of a protest vote against the, I would call it the corporate financial power structure of the country. So to our topic for tonight, anti-establishment sentiment, you have anti-establishment sentiment on both the right and the left. One is targeting the financial and economic and corporate power structure of our country, and the other one is targeting targeting the political power structure of the country. That's the commonality that's going on. And final point is the internet allows those frustrations to be expressed and for people who have those frustrations to be empowered like never before. And that's what's different about what happened this year from previous years.
I agree with so much of what Justin said, except for one of the premises, which is that there's not really a reason for this dissatisfaction, that the indicators are all really good. Interest rates for Wall Street banks have been at 0.25%. For my students at law school, they're 7, 8, 9, 10%. You know, the unemployment rate is down, and I'm sorry to agree with Donald Trump, but it's because so many folks have fallen out of the labor force. The labor participation rate is like at the lowest level in decades. So people are really suffering. African American men are more likely to end up in prison than ever get to college. There are a lot of problems facing normal folks that just don't get addressed. So there is this angst, there's this fear, and it does manifest itself politically in populism on the right and the left.
How much of this is driven by income inequality, which by all accounts is getting worse, and I think our region was just named, if not the top region for income inequality, then pretty close.
I think the income inequality is both a consequence of these trends, but also a cause of a lot of them.
This is where I agree with Tim 1,000%. Instead of spending $1 trillion on Wall Street and $1 trillion on state governments, we should have spent $2 trillion on building infrastructure and rebuilding the country.
Amen.
But we did bail out the unions and Wall Street. And that's who we ended up bailing out in 2008 and 2009, the unions, is their complaint, and Wall Street, which is your complaint. And what Franklin Roosevelt did was he let the banks fail, and he let the states fail. That's what he did in 1933. Now, I don't know if we could have afforded that without having riots in the streets in this country in 2009 and 2010. I mean, there was no credit available, and if we let all the union pension funds go under, you know, who knows? I mean, that's the decision that was made in Congress and by the president, to bail out Wall Street and bail out the states. You know, but the problem is we are not talking about any of these things honestly anymore. The three largest things that we spend money on as citizens are middle class entitlements called Social Security and Medicare, and defense spending. The fourth largest thing we spend money on is interest on the debt, all right? We don't spend money on education or any of these other things. That's just Fox News and MSNBC screaming at each other. All we do is spend three quarters of the federal government's budget is defense spending, Social Security, and Medicare. Okay?
And hasn't that been true for the past at least four decades?
No,
well, the interest debt has grown.
The interest has grown. And we were only paying interest, but no, that has not been true for the last, in 1965, 5% of the federal budget was research and development when we went to the moon. We are no longer doing things like that. We are spending money on old middle class people and defense spending. Now we as citizens need to decide, right, whether or not and how to adjust that if we're going to. But we need to start talking about it pretty honestly, and both parties need to do that.
But you're never going to get there when you have career politicians making decisions, and really what they're making decisions on is how they get elected in the next 2 years. And so when you do that, and Tim was channeling his best rigged system argument, and I think he's right, and there is a rigged system argument that you cannot change unless you structurally go at it and say, Washington, you shut down the source of power with respect to Washington, and that is really one source. You shut down the revenue, and you let it go, and you push it down to the states. And so when rigged system is, the way you do that is you shut down government, and you make sure that government is right-sized. Government should not be solving every one of our problems. As much as it sounds great, look, I got three kids, one just graduated college, one's in college, and one's about to go to college. I would love for it to be free, but it's just not. And the fact of the matter is, because of governmental loans, it has actually increased the cost of getting an education in our country. And so we can talk about that, but the fact is that you're not going to change that when you have politicians dialing for dollars 80% of the time and being concerned about taking really strong positions on things they absolutely believe in. I would like to see a discussion at our political levels about what the appropriate role and scope of government should be. Tim and I, you and I could have that debate. Maybe we wouldn't agree on much, but we could have a good civil debate over that, and that might be more beneficial than whether or not 10 women or WikiLeaks or whatever it is, what we saw in the last presidential debate. And that is more important about what Americans want from their government, whether they're federal, state, or local governments.
You know, both Ed and Mitch have talked about the need to be discussing these issues and debating them. And I'll tell you, having come off of this campaign, I think this is the way the system is really rigged in some ways in favor of incumbents. You know, I had to pester my opponent to get one Sunday morning 8 a.m., at least it wasn't 4 a.m., debate. But in
all, we were pestering with you, just for
that.
The record.
I know that. Thank you. But, you know, in all of Broward County on August 30th, in all the races, I think that was the only debate. So how are voters supposed to make up their minds? Based on lawn signs? You know, we dumbed down the electorate. And to me, the Democratic Party that I'm a member of did a disservice, or does a disservice, when it doesn't require all of its candidates to debate in the primaries. And the news media does a disservice when they give endorsements without requiring the candidates to debate.
Let's delve into the media aspect, because everybody here brought up the media. That's something that I could probably talk on at length for a little bit. But here's my overarching question about the media and the dumbing down, your words, of the audience. In my world, I will tell you, what we do is absolutely audience dependent. If the audience wants it, we give it to them. If they don't, we don't. So what comes first, the chicken or the egg? When we present, we meaning just media in general, present some thoughtful, meaningful, information-packed news, and no one's watching. But when we talk about the tapes from Access Hollywood and Donald Trump and Bill Clinton's, you know, alleged actions, people want more. What comes first, the chicken or the egg, and how do you fix it, Mitch?
Well, I think that here's the problem. The problem is there's a big difference between popularity and leadership. We have conflated them in this country. If you're popular, you're a leader, right? That is certainly not the way Harry Truman looked at it. He left office with a 17% approval rating, but he single-handedly is the person you have to thank for sitting in the chair that you're sitting in right now and not having to worry about whether or not the Soviet Union has bombed the crap out of you. So, popularity and leadership are two different things. And the news media is in the business of popularity. And since now candidates can only reach you through some sort of televised screen, they have gotten into the business of popularity, not leadership. So you, as part of the intelligent community that is going to decide, only 20% of us have college degrees. Only another 7% of us have community college degrees. 27% of the American electorate is in some form or another college educated. As Hillary Clinton unfortunately said, the rest of you are just deplorable. So the point is that the electorate is seeking popularity, not leadership. So those of you who are leaders must demand leadership of the leaders.
The problem is that we don't expect our public, the public, we need to expect more. And so we need to provide tools to the public. I actually agree at some level with Tim around education. There needs to be at the start, not at college. College is too late at that time frame. But when you talk about kindergarten and on up, people need to have opportunities and choices. Parents need to be empowered to make choices on behalf of their kids so that they can be an educated consumer is our best customer. Remember that old advertisement? And I think that makes for a better electorate. Instead, what we've done, not only have we done that, we've pigeonholed people into failing schools at the lower level, but we've allowed safe rooms and safe spaces at colleges because, God forbid, someone got offended by hearing another side of an issue at a college. How crazy is that? That's the time in your life you should be challenged about what it means, what socialism means, what communism means, what capitalism means. Those are things that need to be discussed among, and you know, every social issue needs to be discussed, and people's views need to be challenged at that part of their life. That is so vitally important to the college experience. We've lost that.
And then when those people go to rallies like Trump's rally today and call people names and find it okay to have a space to exhibit their most base behavior, what happens then?
Well, look, we need, so part of the education needs to be on the other side as well. So when you allow people, when you give people the skills so they can express themselves in an appropriate way, and then debate a topic from a, some level of knowledge, that is more appropriate than the guttural reaction, whether we're getting on a guttural reaction on a liberal side or on the left side of the aisle or on the right side of the aisle. And so you see some of that spill over in both sides, in both conventions, because most of the people who are drawn to those things would never consider voting for the other side. And the sad part is, there are things I've actually learned from Mitchell Berger over the years. I've rejected most of them, but I've learned. I have learned some things from him, and at least, at the very least, sharpened my skills and my understanding of what my beliefs are based upon some things he said that I find abhorrent.
Tim?
I agree. Well, I agree with a lot of what Ed said about the quality of education. And I've been teaching at law schools around this country for 20 years, and it always shocks me that these are students who have graduated from college already, and their level of knowledge of American history and world history, just 20th century history, is really so low. So what are they learning in college? What are they learning K to 12? I think it's a cultural problem as much as a political problem at this point. But it is ironic, you know, we have the internet, people have all the information in the world at their fingertips, and yet the electorate continues to get dumbed down. And I don't think the political leadership, I agree, it's not much leadership, helps in any way. I do want to just backtrack just for a moment. Mitch has been saying that the government spent $1 trillion on the Wall Street banks and $1 trillion bailing out the pension funds.
Well, giving it to state governments, which used it to bail out pensions.
In 2009 and 2010, in those 2 years alone, the Federal Reserve made $29 trillion in loans at 0.25% for Wall Street banks. Right. So it's not $1 trillion the banks got, it's a lot more.
I agree.
You compare that with what the Federal Reserve did in the 1930s and 40s when it made loans directly to Main Street businesses. And you mentioned that Franklin Roosevelt let the states fail. You had the Reconstruction Finance Corporation, an infrastructure bank that Bill Clinton and Barack Obama promised when they ran for president that every major industrial country has, and we do not have. The Reconstruction Finance Corporation during the Great Depression bailed out the Chicago school system.
Right, no, Tim is absolutely right, but until it took hold, right, it wasn't until 1938 or 39 that it took hold. So you basically had 22% unemployment until you put the capital on the ground and you got the jobs going. A lot of people, both in the Republican and Democratic Party, in the highest, did not think the country could survive that this time. I don't know if they were right or wrong, but they didn't think the country could survive it. So look, in terms of the education piece, only 22% of the people enter Broward Community, Broward College for a 2-year degree graduate, right? It's not that much higher. But the last time I spoke to Greg Hale, it was 22%. So you know, only 65%, I think, is the number of people who go to high school in this state graduate with a 4-year degree in 4 years. So before you start paying for college for everyone, let's try and get everyone out of high school, right? And then let's worry about getting college for everyone. I mean, but that's part of the special interest problem that even exists within my party. Young, educated people supported Bernie Sanders and they wanted a free education, right? Instead of worrying about the high school kids who still aren't graduating from high school in 4 years.
So I'm not sure we've lessened the stress level at all with this discussion, but let's take some questions from the audience. Mayor, do you have a...
That's right, I can direct this to Justin if I can. How do we restore the civility post this election? I mean, we've seen the tone, it started in the Democratic and Republican primaries. What can we do to restore the civility?
Thank you, Mayor. That's a tough one. Glenn referenced earlier today some of the behavior that's taking place in some of these rallies. And this could look, you can always find examples of candidates that have made coarse allegations against their opponents going back to the 19th century, 18th century. I view some of this lack of civility, part of it, not all of it, but the lack of civility is to the frustration, to the alienation, to the dislocation, the dissatisfaction, the cynicism that exists that then turns into anger when people feel that they're being ripped off, that the system is rigged, that the system is stacked in favor of the big against the little. And I think that's one of the things that fuels the lack of civility, one of the things. But to answer your question, so I want to understand a little bit of the cause, but to answer your question, my only answer is leadership, is the candidates themselves, the campaigns themselves have to set an example. That's the only way I know to change it. And they have to set the example. If they set a bad example, then their followers, their supporters are gonna follow their example. If leaders don't act with civility, who else will? No one. So I know that sounds like maybe a simplistic answer. I guess the other part of this, which I really haven't thought through too much, though, is what impact the internet has on the lack of civility. Every now and then, I'll go on Fox News or I'll go on CNN or something, and a couple times I said something very critical of one politician or another, and people like hunt me down on the internet and they tweet messages at me and call me stupid and all kinds of nasty names and things like that, and people don't even know me. So it's just, I kind of looked at it kind of weird and didn't really understand why people would do that. But again, my sense is that that's a symptom of the alienation, the frustration that people feel, and they're kind of raging against the machine and raging against the establishment that they feel is stacked against them. And the internet gives them a voice, gives them a means, gives them a mechanism to express that in a way that they couldn't express it before.
So we could either take the internet away or unrig the system.
And there's anonymity to it that fuels that as well.
Hi.
Questions?
Broward College, by the way, is one of the top community colleges in the country, and our completion rate is a little bit higher than you said. Just want to shout that out.
Well,
you've been fact-checked.
No,
that was done so kindly and respectfully.
No, well, Greg told me it was 22% when I had lunch with him.
That's the state average.
You've been
fact-checked. Broward Community College is different.
You've been fact-checked.
What is yours?
It's all right, buddy.
Oh, 34%.
Right. 34, okay.
And 43 completion. 43% completion.
34% in 2 years. The state average is 22%. My point is made, right?
Well,
you need to worry about graduating kids from high school and community college before you pay for kids to go to four-year colleges.
Respectfully, my question is to the next generation. I teach a class on an honors capstone that is engaging, and Ed, with all due respect, we have a safe space so that they will actually open up their minds, think about the political systems that you mentioned, come up with their own opinions, and not be criticized or demonic, is that the word that we used for it before? They are so turned off by, with all due respect to you, the media. They are sponges that are absorbing the bullets that are being put out every day, and you are killing them. Not you, but not you individually.
And not Local 10 is what
right,
you really want to say.
Absolutely. But it is killing them. It is killing their belief in our country. It is killing their belief in our system. And more importantly, it's killing their involvement in the future.
And
what do we do with that? We're already kind of, we've made, you think that 30% of America thinks we're doing all right? Let me tell you, if you take that number and put it 25 and under, they don't think that. They're scared. Yeah. They want a college education because they've been told that they can't find a job otherwise.
You know,
please respond.
Wait, I'm not, what was the question?
The question is, what do you do about the next generation?
Yeah.
We know how they communicate. You're absolutely right. Newspapers are not the way to do them. They are absorbing bits of information. So where's our responsibility?
So I'm not a big believer in everybody gets a trophy.
Neither am I.
Okay?
I actually think that the hover parent generation, I've got your kids in the class, didn't work.
I'm not a big believer in that. I'm a big believer in providing my kids the tools to deal with what life brings them. And, you know, and the fact is there's going to be offensive people out there, and they're going to have to deal with them. And with all due respect to your safe spaces, too bad. They need to deal with it and stand up. If they believe in something, then they'll take all comers on. They need to understand that life is not fair. They need to have some level of callus on their skin and on their hands and in their minds so that they can deal with what life throws them. If you provide a cushy space for students all the way through Broward College or whatever college, then they are not prepared for what happens when they leave college.
We're not supplying a, absolutely.
This is where I'm going to agree with Ed, okay? China has 1.6 billion people. The top 1% of China is 160 million people. Those 160 million people are now competing directly against all of us. They are just as smart as the top 10% of this country, which is only 30 million people. This is an international economy. You see this? This takes away 10,000 jobs a day. It takes away 10,000 of the old jobs that used to exist a day, right? These kids are gonna have to deal with that. You know what's gonna unemploy more people than anyone else? Driverless cars. You know, most of the males in this country who don't have high school or college or complete college education make their living by driving something. As soon as we have driverless cars, they join the unemployed. So in terms of the division of wealthy people, capital will always grow quicker than labor. Returns to capital will always grow quicker than labor. So we who are fortunate need to understand that. As capital is growing, those who are labor will not catch up as quickly. If you want to maintain this country at some level, capital is going to have to kick in more. And we're going to have that conversation.
What do you mean by kick in more?
It's going to have to either be taxed at one level or another. It's going to have to happen.
Yeah, that's smart. That's smart. Because let's be honest, what you're talking about is a brave new world with respect to driverless cars devices in your hand. And here's the thing.
It's all going to happen.
Government is not nimble enough to keep up with the speed of that. So, I mean, to be blunt,
You have a D-plus infrastructure in this country right now. You can tax capital, put it back to work, and have people grow infrastructure from which small business will then reemerge.
Wow.
That is traditionally what this country has done, from giving away railroad beds to state colleges to the what happened in the 30s. We haven't done it in a long time, and we now have a D-plus infrastructure.
And it is those businesses and those entrepreneurs who provide the nimbleness for the new job opportunities of the future,
after the first,
not government.
After the first capital is put down. That's been true since the Roman Republic. Aqueducts and conduits were built by the government, and then small business came in afterwards.
That's always
happened.
What else the government did? You know, this question started off talking about education.
Abraham Lincoln.
Well, she was talking about education. I know what you're saying about Lincoln and the land
railroads,
grants.
Railroads, okay? And the land grants.
The GI Bill. I saw what it did for my family, what it did for the middle class in this country after World War II. And it gave 16 million returning servicemen in uniform and women in uniform the opportunity for a tuition-free higher education. To say that we cannot afford it, I don't buy that at all. You know, John Kennedy in 1960 talked about the federal government subsidizing local school teacher salaries, K-12 public schools. The K-12 public schools now are a mess. Teachers should be paid a lot more. There should be a lot more teachers. And if the federal government can find $29 trillion in 2 years for Wall Street, we're rich enough to afford a decent life for ordinary folks in this country. And it's not been happening. I'll say what gives me some hope. In my campaign, we had hundreds of volunteers and field organizers. And the average age of them was probably 22 years old, is my guess. In the home stretch of that campaign, they were knocking on 10,000 doors a week and having at least 2,000 or 3,000 conversations a week. These weren't people who were cynical. They were people who thought the system was rigged, but they were doing something about it. They were practicing democracy.
Thank you. This conversation has really meandered in some interesting places. But let's go back to the subject. Questions?
Hi.
Oh, hello. I didn't realize there was a podium set up back there.
There is. I'm a Broward College student, and I've been following it diligently, and I have a question. So history has taught us that depending on events, coalitions within political parties have changed. A great example is when President Johnson signed the Civil Rights Act in 1964 and then the Voting Rights Act in 1965. And that was in an effort to enfranchise African Americans to contribute to the new voting landscape. So my question for you is, do you think the current election will break similar ground with legislation related to minorities?
I think you stumped him.
Well, I mean, look, in 1948, take it back a few years. In 1948, four people ran for president. Henry Wallace, who was Franklin Roosevelt's first vice president, who was the direct he's a socialist. Strom Thurmond, who was the antecedent to Donald Trump. Thomas Dewey, who was the antecedent to Jeb Bush, and Harry Truman, who is the antecedent to Hillary Clinton philosophically. I'm not saying temperamentally, philosophically. So these four strands of American politics have existed for a long time.
Wait, you hear that noise? It's Harry Truman spinning in his grave.
Right. No, these four strands of American politics have existed for a long time. After the 64 and 65 situation, George Wallace ran for president in 1968, and he took the five southern states in the Electoral College. Richard Nixon created a southern strategy in which he adopted the South and brought them into the Republican Party, which was a populist movement. George Wallace was a populist movement. It was not, he believed in high taxes, he believed in social benefits, as long as they were for white people and not black people. So that was George Wallace's position. That was brought into the Republican Party through Richard Nixon and a Southern strategy. Ronald Reagan consolidated those games in 1980 in running against Jimmy Carter as an electoral strategy. Sarah Palin was part of that. Donald Trump is now the antecedent to that. The Tea Party is part of that. in terms of what legislation you're looking at for minority voters, you know, obviously, if you're looking for more voting rights legislation, I think both parties traditionally would have come together on that. The Tea Party is preventing that from happening in Congress right now. So I don't know that anything post-election will happen on that.
Well, Justin, let me redirect my question then.
Can we just let Justin
No,
have
that's fine. I'll answer after she answers.
Well, I just wanted to ask, well then, if do you think either of the parties will experience a difference in coalitions?
A different what?
In coalitions.
A difference in coalitions? Yes. I think that what I find an interesting feature of this election is how divided both parties are. The Democratic Party is divided between the Sanders people and the Clinton people. Now, I'm not saying the Sanders people won't vote for Clinton for president, they will. But we have to keep in mind, people don't have to vote. They don't have to go to the polls, they don't have to fill out their ballot. They can stay home and not vote. And obviously the Republican Party is divided. You know, it's strange for me as a Republican to hear the nominee for president for our party criticize free trade. That's not something I'm used to hearing from the nominee of our party. You know, again, this goes to Donald Trump being more of a populist. In the last debate, if you watched the last debate, he called NAFTA, which was signed by Bill Clinton, the North American Free Trade Agreement, which created a free trade zone between Canada, the United States, and Mexico, the worst trade deal in the history of the world. And again, that was supported by Republicans and signed by a Democratic president. And he was pointing his finger at Hillary Clinton, the Democrat, and saying, your husband signed it. And I don't know, I'd be curious to hear what Tim thinks about it, but my guess is, and I may be completely wrong, and I'm sure he'll tell me, is that, Tim, what do you think about the North American Free Trade? Do you think it was a good deal or a bad deal?
The first time that a first world country entered a free trade agreement with a third world country which could not protect labor or environmental standards. And then when we talk about free trade with the People's Republic of Red China, my dad's generation would not have had a free trade agreement with the Soviet Union. We're fine with having a trans-Pacific partnership with Brunei, where they practice Sharia law, where homosexuality is punishable by death by stoning, with Malaysia, which one of the leaders in the world in sex trafficking, Vietnam, where girls work in factories for 50 cents a day. How is it free trade when you have trade with unfree slave states? So I was going to answer the question in a way that I don't think anything's going to get much better for the African American population under the next administration, whether it is Trump or Clinton. I think the special interests, the big corporate interests that rule these days, which is why we have a distribution of wealth and income more top-heavy since the Gilded Age, is going to continue to rule. You know, this program was, can the establishment parties survive the politics of hate and the anti-establishment movement? The establishment parties are killing this country. They're not taking care of the needs of ordinary folks. The politics of hate and the anti-establishment movements are backlashes against a corporate-dominated establishment that cares only about its own greed and its own satisfaction. And I just can't believe, you know, there are families that have billions and billions of dollars. The Walton family has more wealth than the bottom half of America combined. They could live a million lifetimes and can't spend that money. There's something seriously wrong with both parties right now. I don't think they're going to address these problems at all.
May I disagree with Tim? Look, I agree with Tim that capital is growing a lot quicker than labor wages are growing. And the traditional way in a mixed capital economy is to tax capital and then have a fiscal program that puts infrastructure back to work. That is the traditional way we have done it through mixed capitalism. We tax capital, we then put infrastructure programs in place, and small business grows from there, which was has been the traditional American model for almost 150 years. We've gotten away from that. I don't know why we have. That's another conversation for another day. In terms of the free trade, while it is quite clear to me, my daughter is the Deputy Chief of Staff to the Secretary of the Navy. She travels the world. She goes to all of the countries that Tim just mentioned, who will be happy to do the TPP with China. They'll be happy to do that deal with China. If you want to know what will be the worst thing that ever happens to the American middle class, it is if the dollar is no longer the reserve currency of the world. If the dollar is no longer the reserve currency of the world, your purchasing power, everyone in this room, will go down 20%. If we do not have the TPP and we do not have other trade deals, the dollar will no longer be the reserve currency of the world. The Chinese currency will be the reserve currency of the world, which will start destroying the middle class even worse in this country. There are other things to do to help the middle class in this country, right? But one of them is not to suspend free trade.
Very quickly, because our producer is holding up these stops.
Yeah, you know, I keep hearing that the TPP is necessary to as our pivot to Asia, to prevent China from having these trade relations with these other countries. And it creates these false dichotomies that it's got to be this particular type of a trade relationship. You look at the details of the TPP, investor state dispute settlement provisions that allow huge corporations to challenge our environmental laws and be paid compensation with the rulings not made by U.S. courts, but by offshore arbitration panels stacked with corporate lawyers. I mean, you know, give me a break. This is just a trade nightmare. You know, yes, these are made in China. You're telling me Apple could not make these in this country? Apple's sitting
on
hundreds of billions of dollars of profits.
So you have set up a really great subject for the next dinner series. Can I just say that to be in a room with such brilliant people and such engaged people is just such a joy, and I really do thank you for having us here tonight. We need Adriana?
Yes, so we are going to take two more questions. If you need to leave
Did you see that stop sign she was holding?
I know, but I negotiated with her. If you do have to leave, now's the time to pop up and go, but we're going to take two more questions. Thanks.
Kareem?
This has been fascinating. I really enjoyed this. So special interests, career politicians, having to raise money 24/7, both the right and the left criticize each other, scream and yell about it. You have pundits talking about it. Citizens are upset about it, but yet there's no leadership. There's a very simple solution. Why isn't there campaign finance reform? Why doesn't both the right and the left have leadership and do something about this? Is it because they're really dishonest and they want to really control all those dollars and, you know, keep their positions, and like you said, you know, people that are incumbents? I mean, it's really a shame. You'd think that something could be done very simply, like in Canada. What do you think about that?
I think the politicians are, the current system works for them. The current system works for them. It works for the special interest groups. They when you get power, you take actions to keep it. And the people that are in power are going to keep the rules, and the rules are going to favor them keeping that power. However, the gentleman to my left just demonstrated that the internet is a form of campaign finance reform. It's, again, don't misunderstand me. It's not the same as passing a law that changes the way campaigns are funded. However, you do now have, because of the internet, the opportunity for Bernie Sanders to raise $231 million to Hillary Clinton's $231 million, and you have an opportunity for someone who's running against the chair of the Democratic National Committee, who can raise money from all over the country. Now, Tim can raise money from all over the country because of the internet. So I would say that in some sense that the distribution of power that the internet represents does allow, in ways that haven't been allowed before, for people that would have been crushed, would have had no chance, would have raised $100 to $100 million, now actually can run TV ads, can actually send mail pieces. And that was not possible. And the last point I'm going to make on this is that, you know, Barack Obama is known as the first African-American president, which he is, obviously. But from my perspective, maybe as important, if not more important, he's the first internet president. That's right. What do I mean by that? there's, and Mitch probably can speak at length at this, but Barack Obama had no business defeating Hillary Clinton in the Democratic primary in 2008. And when I say no business, what I mean by that is 20 years earlier in 1988, a two-year senator, U.S. United States senator, could not have defeated the former first lady of the president, popular eight-year president, two-term president, Bill Clinton, senator from New York, with all the political establishment, with all the ambassadorships that Bill Clinton appointed, with all the Wall Street connections she had from being the senator from New York, and somehow, some way, Barack Obama defeats her. It's unthinkable. Well, it's really unthinkable. Okay, and outraised her money. Right. He raised $750 million that year. $500 million of that was raised on the internet. Hillary Clinton came to town. Maybe it was at Mitchell's house. I don't know, but I remember reading about it. When she came in 2007, she had the typical. Oh, that's right. You weren't. Forgive me. Right. She had the typical $2,000 come to the event. $2,000. Barack Obama went to the Kravitz Center in West Palm Beach, and he said, "You can come to my fundraiser with $25 in your email address." He amasses an email list of 13 million people, and every time he sent out an email, he raised $1 million. When they asked his campaign manager at the end of the campaign, "What would you have done differently?" He said, "I would have sent out more emails." Okay, so Barack Obama, and think of, now last point I want to make on this, think about this. Barack Obama is the first internet president. You take away the internet, how long would it have taken this country to have an African-American president? Okay? 100 years, 50 years, 75 years. So the reason, in my view, that allowed someone, the most improbable person, I shouldn't say the most improbable, I don't want this to sound like, Barack Obama is an incredibly talented, gifted, intelligent, competent, but when you think about it in terms of the power structure of the country, the power structure of the Democratic Party, she had all the levers of power. She had all the levers of financial power, and all he had was the internet. But that's all he needed to win.
There are so many good points there, and yet I must respectfully say I think it's a little bit overstated. Obama, when you read his book, The Audacity of Hope, he is praising Robert Rubin. He had a lot of Wall Street support in the primaries against Hillary. He outraised John McCain on Wall Street by a lot. And while Bernie Sanders and while my campaign shows that you can raise money through the internet, we're the exception that proves the rule. I can't tell you how many congressional candidates and state and local candidates around the country drop me a line. They want to know what's the secret formula. Well, when you have an opponent who's vilified the way my opponent got vilified, I would argue she deserved it, but that's another story. It's easy to use the internet, but there's only so much room there. The U.S. is one of the only democracies in the world. I think there are only six democracies that don't have federal campaign finance, publicly financed elections for federal officials.
Well, let me disagree with Tim again. You do not want the federal government to pay for elections. That is fascism, okay? That is when you institutionalize parties above ideas. You don't want that. Now, you don't want the current campaign finance system either. You want citizens to participate. Corporations, contrary to my friend Mitt Romney, are not people too, okay? Nor are unions. These are artificial constructs that we have created through legislation to say, you are a corporation, you are a union. When the founders of this republic gave First Amendment rights out, they gave them to citizens, people, flesh and blood. They did not give them to economic constructs called corporations or unions. And that is the biggest problem with the current system after Citizens United. So you might want to put limits on how much an individual can give, but you do not want corporations or unions to be able to give, and you do not want the federal government to institutionalize two parties.
Well, I would agree with the last point on that, but I would say this. When you took away the ability of parties to participate in raising money and you limited their ability to fund campaigns, and you shifted that to more shadowy groups, that come and then they disappear. Those shadowy groups cannot be held accountable. So they could say and do whatever they want and then they disappear. You don't even know who they're behind. Both Republican, one good thing about party system is that Republicans and Democratic Party would survive, likely, survive an election season and could be held accountable post-election for their behavior at some level. Now, I would say that the internet, I totally agree with Justin. The one other point, someone asked a question about, and I'm sorry that some of the folks left. Minority communities have long been taken for granted by many politicians, and it's not necessarily limited to one party or another. But they stop serving that community when they become taken for granted. And what you see over a long period of time in places like Chicago and Detroit and places like that where there is true social injustice there, true poverty, generational poverty, because the same old programs and the same old political structures are serving the same old people, and it's not the people who they need to serve. And so when you're taken for granted, you don't get response. And the one side thing, whether or not it's true or not, whether you believe the truthfulness, there is a certain element of truth when someone says, hey, you have been served in a certain way all these years, why not try something else? Now, that candidate sometimes is inarticulate around those things, but I do believe that there is a benefit for no group to be taken for granted, but no group to simply vote as a block, because when you do that, you lose your ability to be paid attention to.
Thank you.
Could I just have a very quick response? I agree with Mitch that Citizens United, I think he was alluding to, all this corporate money is a real danger. In fact, some would say that's fascism, when there's very little room between the state and the corporate interests, is the very definition of Mussolini's kind of fascism.
Exactly.
Okay. And I know that I had a super PAC that was spending $1 million against me of dark money.
That's right.
However, I mentioned the U.S. is one of only six democracies in the world. We're in, like, with Honduras and countries like that that don't have publicly financed elections. To say that countries like Germany and Britain and France and Denmark and Sweden, where they have publicly financed elections, to call them fascist is really not right.
The definition and, of fascism and they have when multi-parties, the government pays for politics.
And they have multi-parties there. They do. They're not enshrining a two-party system.
Okay, we have time for one more question.
Well, thank you. The last question. Now, we've heard some interesting analysis of elections from the 19th century and the 20th century, and you wonder, are these events thought to be that the past is prologue for the future? But within the context of the theme this evening of the trauma, post-election trauma, one wonders, you know, you've seen the response of the base for when Trump in the last couple of days has been speaking to his base. The enthusiasm is very great. So one wonders, are we having a bull moose moment here? What is going to happen looking forward to the, is Trump possibly looking forward to the 2020 elections? And what would the impact be of this?
So I think that if Trump loses, he has a very devoted, dedicated following. And he's got their email addresses. He could turn that into a political force. And he's already kind of showing that political force by now, because Paul Ryan, the Speaker of the House, isn't necessarily supporting him. He's starting to take shots at Paul Ryan. Senator John McCain from Arizona withdrew his endorsement of Donald Trump. And now Donald Trump's kind of trashing John McCain, and that's gonna create problems for him. And I speak to a lot of Republican elected officials here in Florida, some who are running for election November 8th, and I was speaking with some of them this week and in their campaigns, and the one question that they are, I don't know if say struggling, but the challenging question for them to answer is, are you voting for Donald Trump? And it's a dilemma for some of these elected Republicans running, because you say yes, and now you've alienated people that don't like Trump. Some of those people are Republicans, some are independents, some are moderate Democrats. And then if you say no, then the base of your support as a Republican elected official running for election can fall away from you. So I think that to answer your question, there both parties are being fractured. I was asking Tim a little bit earlier before we started, you know, what happens with the Bernie movement if Hillary Clinton loses? You know, will Bernie kind of lead a new movement, or will there be someone else like an Elizabeth Warren, or is there some progressive governor or progressive member of Congress or elected official out there that can take the Bernie mantle and keep that group motivated to keep, you know, to maybe have a president the next time? I mean, it's really remarkable when you think about it. I talked about Barack Obama being Hillary Clinton. If Hillary Clinton had chosen not to run this year, Bernie Sanders would have been the Democratic nominee of the Democratic Party this year. So I think that on both sides, you have movements that can have legs after the election, regardless of who wins.
But don't mistake something. Assuming Hillary Clinton wins and Donald Trump disappears off of the political stage.
Or challenges the results.
Well, and that's a whole other, you know, so that's a whole other discussion. But look, don't mistake the messenger for the message, and that's important. There is a group, a large group and growing, of people who feel that the system and the status quo are not listening to them. And so whether or not you like Donald Trump, whether you like Bernie Sanders, they are messengers. But the underlying message is that people are very unhappy with what has gone on with our federal government, and I think that's not going away anytime soon.
Look, if you remember, I talked about Strom Thurmond being the historical antecedent to Donald Trump.
All right, Mitchell.
George Wallace took five states in 1968. And Nixon saw that and married that to the Republican Party. The Democratic Party used to have this group of people. They are now part of the Republican Party. And as Justin said, the Democratic Party has Henry Wallace, who is now Bernie Sanders. Whether or not these coalitions maintain or not are a different issue. The Republican Party, the Nixon's Wall Street and George Wallace's Alabama, married together in 1968. Whether or not that marriage can sustain itself past this election is the issue for the Republican Party. Whether or not the Henry Wallace marriage, right, the Henry Wallace Bernie Sanders coalition will maintain itself as part of the Harry Truman Democrats, whether or not Tim Canova and I can stay in the same party, is going to be the issue for the Democratic Party. So, and whether or not and how these things reformulate. What I think all four of us agree on is that the middle class has been completely neglected by both parties over the last 10 years. Completely neglected by both parties. We gave health care to poor people. We gave the hole in the donut to senior people. We bailed out the union pension funds, and we bailed out Wall Street. If you live in a house with $150,000 mortgage and two car payments, and you make $70,000 a year, we hurt you over the last 10 years.
Justin gets the last word.
Sorry, real quick. So the other thing about the parties is the fastest growing group of people that register are no party affiliation. More and more people are registering without a party. I refer to that phenomenon as it's the party of one. It's the party of me. It's my party. Whoever I am, whoever I want to vote for on any given day, I'm going to vote for them. I don't care what party they're in. The other thing is the notion of having two parties in modern day America is going to continue to seem more and more anachronistic and more archaic. And the best example I can give for that is if you go to some of these nicer fast food places, if you've ever seen these soda machines, and it has a video screen, okay, it's got a video screen on it, right? And the first screen has like six flavors, and then you kind of, it's a touch screen, and you touch the button, and then from that you get like six more flavors, and then you maybe can touch that button and get two more variations of it, like you want cherry vanilla, or you want lemon lime, you want diet free, diet, sugar-free, caffeine-free. So in one machine, in one soda machine, you've probably got 50 or 60 different flavors of soda, okay? Go to the potato chip section of your supermarket and look at all the different types of corn chips, black bean chips, potato chips, everything you can imagine. So the notion that I have to pick between A and B,
But those are all owned by two companies.
I got a quick question for you. If that's what's going to happen, and you can only afford one bag of potato chips, and you have to agree on it, how do you bring consensus to this?
You can't.
So then you're saying the country's over.
I don't say the country's over. I say that it's going to be more difficult than ever to form governing coalitions and to reach compromise. I do believe that.
You know, it's a really good thing that we don't have to hit commercial breaks here like we do on Sunday morning. But thank you so much, everybody. This has been way fun. All right, turning it over to the boss.
Thank you so much. Let's hear it for our outstanding moderator and panelists. Kelly, I think you have some gifts for our panelists, so we just want to thank you all again for attending, and I'll correct the record. I know the good Mr. Hale is our attorney, but he may not be clear. We have a 32% graduation rate, and since 75% of the students are part-time, it's actually a really good average. It keeps us in the top cohort of the nation, so we're... Thank you, Danielle. All right, so thanks, everyone. We hope you enjoyed the series, and we hope you join us for upcoming dinners. Our next dinner is February 15th, 2017, Prison Reform and the Overcriminalization of America. May 3rd, Why Do We Need Public Hospitals? Takeout Tuesday, November 15th, My Big Fat Gay Marriage, Finding the Middle Ground with Religious Conservatives. That'll be interesting. March 21st, Systemic Poverty, How the War on Poverty Failed. And if you enjoyed this dinner and believe in what we're trying to do, please consider becoming a member. Help spread the word. It's $68 to become a member for the year. We thank you for your support. Thank you to the outstanding panelists. This was a great, great night. You all did a great job of keeping civil. I enjoyed using the bell. Have a great night, everyone.
Tim, I'll buy you breakfast.